what makes them think about the things they're thinking about. Just like, why did I stumble into this world of genetics? Why would I, you know? It's one thing. When my mother died and I was young, it was one thing to say, I have to make a dance about this because I was so hurt that that's the only thing I could have done next was to make a dance about that. But this isn't like that. This is like the world is wide open. So I was visiting a friend of mine named Bonnie Bassler, who's quite an amazing geneticist at Princeton, and she took me down the hall to her colleague, whose name is Eric Vieshaus, who is one of our Nobel laureates. And he was, he said I could look at his fruit flies. I got very attached to fruit flies. In fact, they play a big role in the piece, which I hope will bring, and I hope you'll get to see. We have cheerleading fruit flies, we have enthusiastic fruit flies, and old fruit flies. We have a lot of fruit flies in the piece. But he, we talked for a while, and I looked at what he was looking at. And then I said to him, how do you ask yourself a question? And he said, I am fueled by my ignorance, which, as far as I'm concerned, is the whole deal. That was interesting because we had just started, we were somewhere early in the war in Iraq, and I, for some reason, my response was, I wish our president, our then president, had the same notion that you could be fueled by ignorance in a way that leads to inquiry, that leads to understanding, that leads to collaboration, right? It doesn't have to lead to humiliation and therefore. So, you know, it's interesting, what do we do when we think we don't know something? That's why your response was so great when you said what you said before about, you know, this guy sounds like he doesn't know anything, and I said naivete matters. Actually, I think it does. I think a willingness to say, I don't know, but I can find out because I have some methods and some tools and some training and some techniques and some ways of going about it, then it's pretty exciting. And if I ask a hard enough question, I'll have to come up with new tools, new techniques, new methods. That is really thrilling. The one thing that I did know about genetics before I started this was Gregor Mendel. How many of you, I got it in the fourth grade, right? I don't know. Yeah, a few hands going up. And I decided that I wanted to make Gregor Mendel kind of the spiritual guide of this work for a couple of reasons. One, because he is a religious figure. He was a monk. And I wanted people to know that there have been times in our history when science and religion were not necessarily adversarial. Two, I was interested in him because hardly anybody knows anything about him. So I had a lot more poetic freedom with him than I would with, say, Charles Darwin, who a lot is known about. And three, I think I was drawn to him because he was just terribly obsessive, as am I. Not only was he counting those peas and pollinating them and doing all that, but he was measuring the weather four times a day. He was totally focused and curious. So I want to just show you a little clip, in part to give you a sense of the scale that the piece took early on, and then I can talk to you a little bit about some of the artistic collaboration that goes on in this. So Vance and I are going to work together and set this up. Let's go for that first clip. And partway through, I'm just going to ask him to send it on to the next one. This is very early in the piece, so there's some reasons for its purposeful slowness, but we can go.
Thank you.
it's like, so we're staying within this section, but you're moving to